Maybe, you know, in artificial intelligence, there has been this idea of a Turing test. And Turing came up with this, way to see whether robots or computer systems would already show some signs of intelligence. And he proposed to compare the performance of a machine with the performance of a human. And if, well, I have to stop this because there are children here, so. And he compared with the performance of a human, you know, and if there's no difference, then the Turing test was passed. So the Turing test for humans is not yet passed, but we decided to do something similar with a dog. And there's a piece of meat here, a real piece of meat, and this is a real dog. As you can see, the Turing test for dogs has been achieved, right? Now, okay, so this is all fun, but can we go further with all these robots and all these experiments? Can we address some of the questions that have been raised here today, like questions about body image, maybe about intersubjectivity, about joint attention, and about meaning, about symbol use? And so, and you know, my list goes on. And what is so great about robots is that we can program them, we can put them into action, we can set them in a certain context, we can have them interact with each other. And then, in comparison with human subjects, we know completely what is going on. We can record everything. We really understand the mechanisms. And so we can study, actually, things about language and about body image and about all these other topics by using these kinds of experiments. So I'm going to show you one example of such an experiment, which is really about the question of symbols and language and how a system, an autonomous system like a human or a robot, how they can talk about the world. Now, there's sort of two theories about this. There's one kind of theory which says, well, our brain has some special circuits, whether they be mirror neurons or a language organ or some sort of, you know, we can identify in the brain certain areas that do these things. And then the idea is that it must be related to the neural tissue of the brain. Okay, the material substance. So this is like a material explanation. Now, there's another kind of explanation, which is that all these things that our brain is doing is basically due to a system, due to dynamics, due to a kind of network that's being established between the world, the sensations, the internal representations of the world, maybe symbols, things we do in the world. And so all of these things are kind of coordinated in a dynamical process. But there's nothing special about, you know, how that process is implemented. I mean, obviously, our brains have the capacity to do this kind of dynamics. But maybe we can achieve the same sort of dynamics in other embodiments, like in a robot. And so this is a big debate. And there's, for example, John Searle has proposed this Chinese room virtual experiment, so to speak, where you have a philosopher in a room and he gets little sheets of paper with Chinese characters on them. He looks at them, he looks in a big book, and then writes something on a piece of paper and shifts it under the door again. And so Searle says from the outside it may look that this philosopher inside the room understands Chinese, but in fact, you know, he just looks up in a book, he looks up symbols, and he writes them on a piece of paper and returns them. And indeed, a lot of computer systems do that kind of thing. I mean, if you have the web, for example, if you type in a search engine in Google, you type in some characters, you know, goes in the search engine, does all this kind of search, and comes back with an answer. But of course, Google understands nothing about the world. It's just doing is a giant symbol cruncher, you might say. So, you know, Searle says that's not really understanding, because for real understanding, you know, for really understanding about the world, you need this kind of special substance that only the neural tissue would have. So the experiment that I'm going to talk about is trying to prove the other hypothesis, which is that it's all in networks and in dynamics. And so the experiment that we set up is with these other robots. These are humanoid robots, which are about that tall. And they are a bit more sophisticated than the AIBO that I have shown you on the previous pictures, in the sense that there's three cameras on them. There's all sorts of processors. There's two in the robot. We use additional 8 computers actually around it to do the kinds of things that I'm going to show you. And so we have a world in which we put these humanoids. And what we would like, in fact, is that they self-organize a communication system to talk about their world. So I'm not in the loop. Okay, we just have the robots that are interacting with each other in this particular environment. And I would like that, you know, in the beginning of the day, we just put them in this room, they walk around, they interact with each other, and then when I come back at the end of the day, I expect that these robots, or I would like that these robots, have a kind of language that they invented themselves to talk about the objects in their world. And so, for example, we might see something that one robot, you know, says, Bolima, and then the other robot looks around and then points to it and says, yeah, that's what Bolima is, right? So I don't want to put in any words, of course, but also I don't want to put in any categories already for conceptualizing the world. And this is exactly what we did. So I'm going to show you an example of this experiment in action. And I show actually various clips. They're always the same language game, because that's what it is. So there's always the same interaction, but I'll show you what the robots are seeing and how they build their world model. And then I'll show you how they negotiate, in fact, or create and invent this kind of language. So here is the interaction itself. Basically, the robots are walking around in this world. There may be some sound also here. Until they find a kind of area that they can talk about, okay? So you see these big landmarks also in the environment, which they use to orientate themselves in the room. They look around to see what objects there are, whether there are any other robots to play a language game with. And so if they do, then one selects an object in the environment and describes it to the other robot, and you see the other robot pointing to this object and saying, is this what you meant? No, the other one is checking and says, yes, exactly, that's what I meant. So this is already after playing hundreds and hundreds of language games that they have a successful game, because in the beginning, of course, none of those games is going to work, right? You see also the language there, comida do boa. Well, I mean, I don't know what it means. You know, when we want to study the language that's emerging in this experiment, then we are like anthropologists that have to figure out, you know, the point to this, what could that mean, and things like that. So let me show first a little bit of their internal states. And so you see on the bottom left here is what one robot is seeing. And on the right-hand side, you see what the other robot is seeing through the camera. Okay, now on top, you see on the left and the right, you see that they actually have a kind of window of what they actually see, which slides over the reality. And while they're sliding, they're trying to come up with an idea of what the reality is looking like in terms of the positions of objects, you know, that there are objects. And the little arrows, like these arrows, also indicate where the other robot is with respect to yourself, which is this. And so the robots also have to figure out the position of the other one in order to be able to talk about objects, because what we often do is we need to take into account the perspective from which another robot is looking at the scene or when we talk. You know, if I say the glasses on the left, well, this is on the left from my perspective, of course, because from your perspective, it would be to the right of this particular computer. So language and conceptualization of reality when you are communicating has a lot to do with perspective and changing perspective. So here is again the same, you see a little bit better actually that the model they're making of the world in real time, this is all computed, is actually a 3D model. And then you see the window sliding over the world and you see the position, the angle with which they are looking at. Okay, so let's now see a little bit in more detail how this experiment is working. Okay, let me kill this off. Okay, so the basic idea is that you have a network that these robots are building up, which is on the one hand relating the raw sensory experience that's coming in. Then there's segmentation going on, there's filtering of foreground and backgrounds. There's a collection of sensory features like brightness, estimations of height, and all of those kinds of things. So all this computation, massive amount of computation going on in real time, we can do terrific things on computers today, until the robot gets actually an idea of certain objects in the scene, and then also a kind of sensory experience, which is for all of the dimensions that the robot can perceive, is a kind of value. So you might say a value for brightness or a value for the width of an object. Now, all of these are kind of changing dynamically in time and very approximate, very noisy. You know, they can be, interpretations, right? Because color is always based on the reflection of the light, as we heard in some of the previous talks. So there's nothing like the real reality, if you want to find that out. I mean, the robot gets the sensation of the reality by physical interaction with the sensors. And then when they go from the sensory experience, what they try to do is to compare a sensory experience like of these glasses, let's say, with a prototypical experience that they had of the same object in the past. So they start out with no knowledge about any objects whatsoever. Okay, and the first time they see an object, they see that the object is different from other ones, they create their first prototypes, which is a view, of course, of a particular object. And so these are some examples, you know, of prototypes of the sensory experiences. So, of course, when you, let's take this object here, you see this object, you know, you get a view of this object, you get a prototypical view. So I could change it a bit and it would still be matching with this kind of view, right? Now, if I turn the object around, then the view is going to be very different. So you get a second view of an object. And for a particular object, you might have many different points of view which are all coordinated. Okay, and then you have, so for one particular individual object, you may have different prototypes. And then with these objects, then you have also a lexicon, a vocabulary, which is again associations that are related between the concepts and between those words. And so what happens is that the robots, they build these networks, and then when they have to speak, they will choose the prototype that's best matching with the current experience, so a prototype of past experience, best matching, and then they will look at the concept, the individual that's best matching, and then they will look up the word that has the highest score in their memory, and that's the word they will say. So there's a kind of parallel search process in these networks to find the best solution, okay? And the listener also gets the word, looks up the concept, looks up the prototype, and maps that back into the experience. And so this is going on in each of the agents, which of course each have different networks as they are talking. But after an interaction, or as part of the interaction, the networks are adapted, so they are slightly changed, so that next time you have to talk, you know, you will be slightly more successful, or you will be better coordinated. For example, for a word for this object, if I call it Wabadoo, for example, okay, so you get a prototypical view, you get a name for this view of this object, Now, this is still wabadoo, wabadoo, wabadoo. And so when, you know, when we talk, the memory trace, if you want, becomes more and more solid, and the strength of it is going to increase. And so I'm going to show you a little idea of the dynamics. I mean, this is in a single robot. These are the networks that the robot is building up and how they are changing over time. And so as you can see, you know, you see the sensory experiences, you see prototypes, you see individual concepts, you see the blue is the words. And so new links are being built. The links are becoming stronger. The network is being reorganized. And so this whole thing is a very dynamical system. And I think for every conversation we have, every experience we have, these networks are changing, are coordinating, are in interaction with others, and of course also in interaction with the world. So this is basic the basic idea. Is really networks and dynamics, right? Our brain is capable of sustaining vast networks. We have no idea if you put all computers together in the world, you know, with all the networks and all the internet links and whatever you want to imagine, that would be still be ridiculously simple compared to the vast amounts of networks that we can sustain with our brain. And every time we interact, those networks get adapted. The connections change, more links are being built, as you saw in the in this animation. So this is basically what I think, if we want to understand perception, or if you want to understand, let's say, a symbol use, or something like being able to recognize the intention. I mean, these all seem magical capabilities, but they're in fact the result of a long process of coordination that already starts as soon as you get born. Actually, you start coordinating, for example, perceptions of your own body with the sensations of your own body. So this is all examples of coordination, as we saw in some of the previous talks, that can go wrong. But it's also language and conceptualizations of the world. All these things are these networks that get coordinated. So I think that this is basically the experiment I wanted to talk about. Now, we are doing many other experiments. This is also with the same robots. These are more about body image, and also this question of the mirror neurons that has been discussed before. And so the experiments we do is sort of two robots that, again, don't have any language to talk about actions of their own body. And they play games where they show, you know, one would say, for example, Zoboda Moba. You know, the other one doesn't know what it means, and then he moves up his hand, and then the other will try to learn about this gesture and try to imitate it. And so we put these robots also in also before a mirror, okay, so that they can look at themselves and learn what their body looks like from another point of view. And actually the way that internally, okay, something like this that the robot is seeing is a kind of memory, but very short-term memory of its movement, so that movement becomes a pattern that the robot can recognize. So these are sort of a little peek, if you want, in the experiments that we do. And they're all addressing very similar issues as the ones that neuroscientists or psychologists are trying to address, about color, about body image, about use of language, about conceptualization of the world. But we have this advantage that we can open up, you know, completely the head and try out a new mechanism inside, and that way gain an insight that will inform us when we then start to understand human perception or human body image. We are not yet at the point where we get this out-of-body experience, but I think it would be very interesting to think about what it would take for a robot who is lying there, you know, and then gets this kind of out-of-body experience. I think I'm going to try and do this experiment, and maybe next year when there's another marathon, I can report on it. Okay, so this is sort of the things I'm working on. And I would now like to introduce the two more speakers in the first session here. And the first speaker is Oscar Villarroya. Oscar is from the Barcelona, from the Autonomous University. And he's in the Department of Psychiatry. He's actually a psychiatrist himself and also working in the Hospital del Mar in Barcelona. And Oscar is a remarkable man because he combines the real neuroscience with patients and everything with a very deep philosophical understanding of all the issues that we have been talking about here. So Oscar will talk about emotion and particularly about fear. Now, while Oscar sets it up, maybe, okay,